several and a half metric miles northeast of Sligo, split by a cascading stream, her body on earth, her feet in water, dwells the microcephalic community of Puckoon. This June of a morning in 1924, the whole village awoke to an unexpected burst of hot weather. Gleaming off-white at the foot of Castle Hill were the puzzled, crumbling faces of the peat cutters' cottagers, their glass eyes now dimmed with cataracts of neglect and dirt. The peat had run out 30 years ago, and the peat cutters had run out not long after. Some went to America, the rest stayed behind and hit each other with loaded sticks, but had never really caught on, and they dispersed. The cottagers had been condemned as unfit to live in, except during thunderstorms and depressions. The year after the Troubles, the Irish Free State Government had bequeathed the cottagers to those who had helped rid Holy Island of the English, the Tans, and for that matter, anybody. One such beneficiary was Dan Milligan, son of a famous paternity order. With a roof over his head, he had ceased work, living off his pension and his wits, both hopelessly inadequate. This sun-barbered morning, the Milligan lay full length on the grass, head against the wall, his eyes lost in the shadow of his cap. I think I'll bronze me limbs. He rolled his trousers kneewards, revealing the like of two thin white hairy affairs of the leg variety. He eyed them with obvious dissatisfaction. After examining them, he spoke out loud.
Holy God! What are these then, eh?
He looked around for an answer.
What are they?
He repeated angrily.
Legs. Legs? Whose legs? Yours. Mine? And who are you?
The author.
Author? Did you write these legs?
Yes.
Then I don't like them. I don't like them at all. I could have written better legs myself. Did you write your legs?
No.
Ah, so you got someone else to write your legs, someone who's a good leg writer, and then you write this pair of crappy old legs for me? Well, mister, it's not good enough.
Well, I'll try and develop them with a plot.
It's a diabolical liberty, letting an untrained leg writer loose on an unsuspecting human being like me.
It was a Dublin accent, charged with theatrical innuendo. Like all Irish, he could make good morning sound like a declaration of war, which it usually was. He lay back, the sun grew on.
I must admit you're right. Nice weather, mister.
A bucket of evil-smelling slops hit him square in his sleeping face.
And there's more where that came from, you lazy bugger!
Me hat. Oh, look at me hat.
And if you don't get some work soon...
Ow! Darling, you know full well there's no work around these parts.
Poor Father Rudden is still looking for someone to cut the church grass. I'm going in for 5 minutes. If you're still here when I come out in half an hour...
Ow! Oh, holy God! Who in blazes was that?
Oh, that's your darling little wife.
Wife? Man alive, I thought it was a man. Good God, did you see them arms? Jack Dempsey would be world champion again if he got him. What kind of a writer are you? First me legs and now this great hairy creature.
Don't worry, Milligan. I'll see you come out of this alive.
Alive? Holy Christ, is this a murder mystery? If so, include me out, mister. I'm a Catholic, a Holy Roman Catholic. Now, I'd better get after that job.
He stood up, yawned, stretched, farted, and lay down again.
There's no need to rush at it, he said. Push! Ah! I'm getting out of this chapter. It's too bloody unlucky for me.
The Dan Milligan cycled tremendously towards the Church of St. Teresa of the Little Flowers.
What's new a jury in Dublin town? Her eyes were blue and her hair was brown. One night on the grass they got her down and I...
said a crow.
Balls,
said Milligan.
What's new a jury in Dublin town? Her eyes were blue and her hair was brown.
Father Patrick Rudden paused as he trod the gravel path of the church drive. He ran his kerchief round the inside of his holy clerical collar. Then he walked slowly to the grave of the late Mrs. Griselda Strains and pontifically lowered his ecclesiastical rump onto the worn slab, muttering a silent apology to the departed lady, but reflecting it wouldn't be the first time she'd had a man on top of her, least of all one who apologised as he did. He was a tall, handsome man, touching 50, but didn't appear to be speeding. His stiff white hair was yellowed with frequent applications of anointment oil. The width of his neck and shoulder suggested a rugby player, and the broken nose confirmed it, which shows how wrong you can be, as he'd never played the game in his life. The clock in the church tower said 4:32, as it had done for 300 years. It was right once a day, and that was better than no clock at all. How old the church was, no one knew. It was like Mary Brannigan's black baby, a mystery. Written records went back to 1530.
Money! That was the trouble. Money! The parish was spiritually solvent, but financially bankrupt. Money!
The Lord will provide, but to date he was behind with his payments.
Money!
Father Rudden had tried everything to raise funds, even went to the bank.
Don't be a fool, Father, said the bank manager. Put that gun down.
Money! There was the occasion when he'd promised to make fire to fall from heaven. The church had been packed. At the psychological moment, the priest had mounted the pulpit and called loudly, I command fire to fall from heaven. A painful silence followed. The priest seemed uneasy. He repeated his invocation much louder.
I command fire to fall from heaven.
The sibilant voice of the verger came wafting hysterically from the loft.
Just a minute, Father. The cat's pissed on the matches.
The sound of a male bicycle frame drew the priest's attention. There, coming up the drive, was the worst Catholic since Genghis Khan.
at top of the morning to you, Father.
Well. Dan Milligan, tell me, Dan. What are you doing so far from your dear bed?
Oh, I'm feeling much better, Father.
So you've been ill then?
No, but I'm feeling much better than I felt before.
Yes,
it is unexpectedly hot for this time of the year, Father.
Oh, it's very hot, Mary, very hot. Almost hot enough to burn a man's conscience, eh?
Father.
Yes. When did you last come to church, Milligan?
Oh, I forget now. Ah, but I've got it on my baptismal certificate. My God, Father, what do you think of this weather?
Oh, it's hot all right, Milligan. Listen, Milligan, what is the purpose of this visit?
Well, Father, this grass cutting job is still going.
The inquiry shook the priest into stunned silence. In that brief moment, the Milligan leapt onto his bike with a farewell, sort of job's gone. Goodbye. The priest recovered quickly, restraining Milligan by the seat of his trousers.
Oh, steady, Father. Dim's more than me trousers you're clutching.
Oh, sorry, Milligan. Sorry. We celibates are inclined to forget them parts.
Well, I wish you'd forget mine. Oh.
Yes. Well, now there's plenty of work to be done. Dan, come now and see the garden hut. Michael Collins himself hid in here from the tans.
Did he ever cut the grass?
No, but once when the English was after him, he set fire to it. Oh, what a blaze. 20 courting couples nearly burnt to death.
The priest indicated two solid iron sides.
Now, them's the tools.
Oh, Jesus, they look awful heavy, Father. Would you like to lift one to see if me fears are well-founded?
Sense alive, Milligan. There's no weighting them at all, man. See, no weighting them at all. You can start against that wall there and work inwards. If only I was younger.
God.
As Milligan laboured unevenly through the afternoon, long overgrown tombstones came to light.
R.I.P. Tom Conlon O'Rourke. Not dead, just sleeping. Oh, God, he's not kidding anyone but himself. What was all this dying about, anyhow? It was a strange, mysterious thing, no matter how you looked at it. I wonder what heaven is really like. God, it must be pretty crowded by now. It's been going a long time. I wonder if they have good packed lunches.
The sun bled its scarlet way to the horizon, and the skies nodded into evening.
Well, how are you getting on then, Dan? I think you've done enough for today. It's nearly seven.
Seven? God, trust me to work to a bloody stopped clock.
I know, you mustn't kill yourself, Milligan.
Well, I'm in the right place if I do.
The near godless Milligan trundled his bike towards the Holy Drinker pub.
Oh, I once knew a duty in Dublin town. His eyes were blue and her hair was brown. With night in the grass, they got her down and the horse
I wonder if I'll ever see him again.
Guinness.
Whiskey.
Gin. Beer. Start one.
Stock still they stood, waiting the warm glow that makes us acceptable to all men and vice versa. The first one to feel a powerful benefit was blind George Devine, a thin white El Greco figure with two sightless sockets.
Good evening, all. It's been a lovely day, has it not?
A drop of the real hard stuff now, me lad.
O'Brien was the head man round these parts. He ran the village grocery and took bets. He also had money in the bank, a cousin in America, and a girl in the family way. 40 years old, though a little puffy in the face, he was still a handsome man. Like all men in Puckoon, he was married but single after 6 at night. O'Brien was joined by his friend, Dr. Sean Goldstein. So Semitic did he look that even at all Hebrew parties, people would say, "Who's that Jewish-looking fella?" He had just come from the ailing Dan Doonan, where the patient had been complaining of a slight improvement.
"He's dying for sure. It's a coronary condition. I'll give him the best drugs, but... you know, it's just a matter of time, which I suppose is the sentence we're all under."
"I sometimes think it would be kinder to do away with incurables."
"Oh, nobody's incurable. It's just that we don't know the cure. And remember, what's good for the dying is sometimes bad for the living."
"Eh?"
"Well, if he dies, I'd be worse off. Don't work it out for yourself."
"Oh, yes. You see, I was on the fighting all of the world, you know."
It was little Mr. Pierce in the corner who was holding forth to Fogarty, the idiot of the village.
"I was wounded twice. Once by my own side. You see, the Tans and the police were looking for rebels.
That's
right. They was head up on Clantara Street, you know. One night we could hear them searching the place. All drunk, they were all drunk. Finally, they're breaking into our place. They smashes up the furniture and that's fly a few rounds into the ceiling. Me in the loft, it gets it in the leg."
"Oh, dear."
"Aye, in the leg, you see. And a few days, of course, gangrene, so they smuggled in Goldstein, you see. And what did he do? He off with it."
"Oh, dear."
"It was bloody murder. You should have seen the billy sent me. Still, I survived. A wooden leg, you see. Hollow. Do you know where?"
"No."
"It's hollow because I made it so. You see, my lady wanted someone to smuggle hand grenades out through the police court, and so I hollows me leg, and it travels the bombs in it, you see. And they never caught me."
Oh.
I tell you, a tale of Irish courage and heroism, all you can say is, oh.
Fish.
Fish? What about fish?"
"Well, it's different from owl."
You'd have been in real trouble if them bombs had gone off your leg, mate. Your ass would have been halfway up your back."
The voice came from Thomas Rafferty, who stood 6 foot square. The pockets of his dark green jacket were congealed with blood, fur and feathers. When he wasn't poaching, he was writing bits of poetry, but he lived by the trap. Behind the bar, Mr. O'Toole was speaking to the pig of a face that was his wife. He had married her 20 years ago, but still woke up white and sweaty.
"And where's the Milligan tonight, Marty?"
"I don't know. He was here this morning trying to catch a drink,"
she replied, looking over his shoulder at the handsome O'Brien. She had, in moments of dreaming eroticism, imagined herself clutching his members under the sheets. Whenever she saw a sign, "Members only," she thought of him. The pub door opened, and in bore a podgy police uniform carrying the body of Sergeant McGillicuddy.
"Now I'm here to read a brief notice to all citizens of the Free State. Next week, military and civil members of the Ulster Boundary Commission will be passing through this area. Any hostility towards them will be penalised with fines from a shilling up to death. Thank you, sir. Cheers.
Ah, come on, Standard. Give us one of your love songs. One of them with all that straining and lumps. All right. Ladies and gentlemen.
Order, please.
Silence of the singer.
Quiet.
Order.
I should like to sing the late J. Collard Jackson's lovely song, Eileen. Oh, my Eileen.
He raised the lid of the beer-saturated piano, struck a note, and started singing a different one.
Eileen. You are my queen.
The agonized notes seemed to swell up from the thorax and pass hurriedly inwards towards the back of the head, where they were apparently trapped and reduced by a 3-inch cavity skull. Rebounding, they escaped by struggling down one side of his clogged nose at strength 3.
Oh,
Hey, mister, you got a bogey up your nose.
Oh, my queen. The fine guy. Oh, my.
In a brown and upstairs room at the Duke of Wellington Hotel, Ireland, to quote an IRA leaflet, was being torn in two by traitors. Inside, several high-ranking grim-faced boundary commissioners from both sides faced each other across a giant map of Ireland. Across a map, running from right to left, was a thick red pencil line that terminated just short of the Atlantic. It was threatened as the new border. In its path lay sleeping Puckoon. For 10 whole days now, they had argued the last few miles of frontier. Tempers were frayed, agreements were infrequent, and weak bladders put to the test. Mr. Haggerty was complaining about the Ulster's representative's indecisiveness. He lost his temper, and more frequently, his arguments.
"You'll all be in the Republic one day, so dare." He thumped the map with a fat, furious fist, displacing numerous flags. "May I make a suggestion? We only have this bit here to partition, and the pubs close in an hour. Why not let's all put one hand on the red pencil and draw a line that falls naturally and peacefully into place?" On a show of hands, they accepted his suggestion. In what was meant to be a solemn moment, all hands held the pencil and pulled slowly across the map. All was silent. The room was filled with suspicion. Occasionally a gasp rent the silence as they all strained for the advantage. "Steady! Someone's pulling to the benefit of Ulster."
"Lies! All lies!
Who gave that jerk?"
"Ah, I felt that. Swine!"
Finally, the pencil reached its destination. Faces broke into relieved smiles, and a series of rapid, unplanned handshakes ensued. Inside sternly furnished wallpapered rooms at number 356 Queen Victoria Crescent, Belfast, two young customs officers were packing well-travelled suitcases. Webster was short and handsomish, with ill-cut straight brown hair and grey eyes, all in all a bit of a ladies' man, one bit in particular. By comparison, Peter Barrington, his tall, blonde, rather wavering roommate, looked slightly effeminate. The two had nothing in common save the English language, and even then Barrington had a superior accent for it. Webster and he were both due to organise a customs post along the new border near Puckoon.
I fancy living on the canvas.
I mean, where the hell is Puckoon?
A most irreverent wind whistled through the seams of Major Stokes's military trousers, agitating his pubics as he stood on the station platform.
Puckoon! What a godforsaken place.
He rapped loudly. From behind came the sound of a rusty bolt being withdrawn. The partition slid halfway up, jammed, slammed down again. The second time it rose.
Where are you going to, sir?
I'm not going anywhere.
Oh, good then, good. Oh, you've arrived. Good. Good night.
No, wait. Look, I'm waiting for the train that was due here at 1600. The time is now 1900 hours. You know what that means?
1900 hours? No, sorry, sir. Me watch, it only goes to 12.
Listen, man, it's 3 hours late. I'm supposed to pick up two customs officers.
Oh.
Oh? I mean, can't you phone or something?
No phone here, sir, no. We've only got a letterbox.
But listen, is it usually this late?
I never timed it, sir. Oh, no. Long, it goes backwards and forwards. That's all we care.
You blasted idiot!
All through, sir, yes, all through, very through.
Turning away in a fury, the Major fell heavily over a box. The darkness was filled with clucking chickens and swearing.
Bloody fool! Lift that there!
4 miles up the line, showing no signs of life, was the 6:30 train for Puckoon. The carriage lights, strung like amber beads, hung lustreless in the squalling rain. A weak trickle of steam hissed from the outlet valve. On the footplate, O'Malley, the ginger-haired fireman, looked at the dead furnace.
I can't understand it. That coal bunker was full on Thursday.
Well, 'tis Friday and it's empty.
Now don't lose your temper, Martha. All we need now is something to burn.
Oh, with a fine mind like that, you're wasting your time as a fireman. And you're also bloody wasting mine. Now then, listen, you puddin'.
We passed the cottage a few miles back. Go and see if there's a couple of buckets of coal or peat down there.
Okay.
As O'Malley walked to the cottage, from the carriages came cries of inquiry.
What do we stop for, mister?
Is this Dublin?
What happens if we don't get started?
Hurry up, I want to do a piss.
Well, first-class passengers will be taken on by private car.
Well, what about us third-class passengers?
You get out and bloody well push.
Wearily, O'Malley approached the building and knocked on the door.
Who's there?
Please, ma'am, it's the fireman from the Puckoon Flyer.
Did you fall off then?
No, we've run out of fuel.
Come in.
Oh, thanks.
What is it you want?
Could we borrow a couple of buckets of coal or peat?
Coal I have. Would you like a cup of tea before you go? You look awful wet.
Yes.
Oh, come on. The train's never been on time.
She kept looking at him in a way. He sipped his cup of tea. She was looking at him in that way again. He finished his tea. Dear friends, it's a wonder how one bed can take so much punishment. The springs groaned under the combined assault of two activated bodies. It was an age-old story, but neither of them seemed to have heard it before. And they did it all on one cup of tea. Dear friends, a quarter of a pound of tea can be bought for as little as 2 shillings. And think of the fun you can have in the privacy of your own home. From outside came an angry knocking on the door. From inside came an agonized coitus interruptus.
Oh! God, who can it be?
How the hell do I know?
Anybody in?
It's all right. It's me mate.
Oh, yeah. What the blazes has... Oh, yes.
Well, you know why I was so long.
Sure. I was watching you through the window. Jesus, you've got a spotty bum.
There was a tread of military boots up the church drive. They stopped.
Hey, buddy bear.
Can I help you, gentlemen?
Oh, Vicar, my name's Major Stokes, OC 2nd 4th Ulster Rifles.
And what can we do for you, Mr. Stokes?
Mister? Look, we're here to build a new customs post and erect a border fence.
Oh, well, I don't see how I can help. I've got a bad back.
Oh, dear. Well, look. This here is where it's to be. There. Which lies approximately over there.
What? A customs shed on church ground? I've heard nothing of this. It must be a mistake.
No, it's true, Vicar. I had this official letter this morning.
Well, I received no notification. I shall have to write to Cardinal McQueen in Dublin about all this.
Oh, no, we can't wait for that, Vicar. We've had instructions to start right away.
Very well. If it's the law, I can't stop it, but I think it's damnable, to run a funcier through a churchyard.
There, don't cry. There.
Sunday. Father Rodden clutched the pulpit. He had said Mass at such speed, the congregation were thrown into great confusion. Some were standing, others kneeling, some were leaving, the rest just gave up and sat down. Skipping the sermon, he launched into a secular attack on the new border. If that border is to be permanent, it means that the holy Catholic departed will forever be lying in British soil. Protestant soil! Out there! He pointed in the wrong direction and dropped his voice. I should like for you, who all feel strongly about this, and he raised his voice, and you'd better! He crashed his fist down on the pulpit rail, spitting the wood and evicting a colony of woodlice. He lowered his voice. Sign the petition you will find hanging in the foyer. He stepped down. Dominus vobis cum, he said. Et cum spiritu tuo, they replied. The verger counted the collection. "'Tis a miracle how some of these people's clothes don't fall off," he grumbled, extricating the buttons from the plate. Three miles away, Dr. Goldstein pulled the sheet over the face of Dan Doonan. Mrs. Doonan took the news dry-eyed. She only stayed with him for the money. 20 years before, she had tried to get a separation. The solicitor listened to her attentively.
But, Mrs. Doonan, just because you don't like him, that's no grounds for separation.
Well, make a few suggestions.
Has he ever struck you?
No, I'd kill him if he did.
Has he ever been cruel to the children?
Never.
Has he ever left you short of the money, then?
No, every Friday on the nail.
I see. Wait. Think hard now, Mrs. Doonan. Has he ever been unfaithful to yous?
By God, I think we got him there. I know for sure he wasn't the father of me last child.
That'll be 10 guineas.
The funeral of dear Dan Doonan came treacle slow from the church. They approached the new border customs post. From a hat, a buttoning his coat, came a Barrington.
Good morning. A few formalities, sir. Just read this, will you?
We have nothing to declare, sir. This is a funeral.
I see. What have you got in the coffin?
You must be joking.
I'm not joking, sir. I'm merely doing my duty.
Very well. Inside the coffin is the body of 98-year-old Dan Doonan. Now, please let us pass.
Not so fast now. You intend to bury an Irish citizen in what is now British territory.
Yeah, that is true.
Hurry up. It's going to rain.
Get him over on before another of us passes on.
I got bad legs.
So have I.
I presume the deceased will be staying this side permanently.
Unless somebody invents a remarkable drug, yes.
Then he will require the following: an Irish passport stamped with a visa to be renewed annually for the rest of his stay.
Take him back to the church, lads. We'll have to postpone the burial.
Oh, dear. What a terrible thing to go in.
Inside the photographer's shop, the small green bell tinkled briefly, and in came three men with the dangling Dan Doonan.
Are you the photographer?
Yes. Is he drunk?
No. He's got the leg trouble.
What's his head hanging down for?
Well, he's got leg trouble hanging down up to his neck.
Well, now, just sit him down there in a chair.
Nearly dropped him.
Sorry.
He bruises easily.
I see, yes.
And we want them one of them passport photos.
Oh, is he going away then?
Yes.
Where to?
Well, he's not sure, you see. He's got a choice of two places.
I see. Yeah. Just hold him like that. See? Now, look, I can see. So right. I can see he's an old man.
Yes.
All right, put him there now. Smiley! Smiley, there. That's it. Now. If he's pleased with the result, perhaps he'll come again.
Oh, he'll never be that pleased, said the departing trio, and they carried dear Dan draggledy-draggledy away.